third evening, in order to bring you up to date and connect up what has gone before with the evening's talk, let us briefly recapitulate what we learned in the past two evenings. First, we learned that life is a master drama of nutrition and drainage under the control of the nervous system. We learned that drainage is the process by which blood, lymph, and the tissues of the body are kept sweet and clean. Providing, of course, that process of drainage is normal in all particulars. Yesterday evening, we learned of the many ways in which our functioning powers or capacities are impaired and lowered so that the functions of life are not carried on in an ideal way. This evening, we want to trace further the developments that grow out of this impairment of the functions of life, with particular reference to the impairment of the drainage process. I pointed out to you the other evening that the living body is a poison factor, by which I mean that at all hours of the day and night, asleep or awake, from birth to death, the cells of the body are normally and naturally giving off waste matter, used up material, and that these wastes are toxic, and that in order that the body may be kept free from self-poisoning, the waste must be removed from the blood, from the lymph, from the tissues, as continuously as it is formed. If this process of removal fails, then toxic material begins to accumulate in the blood and lymph and in the tissues, giving us a condition of self-poisoning, a genuine self-poisoning in contradistinction to the absorbed poisons from other parts of the body, from outside the body, that are often referred to as self-poisoning. At this point, let me stop and point out to you that man lives, moves, and has his being between two skins. That is the outer skin that you all can see and know, and that you women, particularly with reference to that part of it that's on your face, give so much attention to. That is, you put on three-coat jobs and two-coat jobs, you color it in various ways, torture it, and so on. But there is an inner skin that is continuous with the outer skin. It is made up of the same type of tissue. And every power organ of the body that communicates either directly or indirectly with the outside world. The nose, the throat, the mouth, the respiratory tube, the esophagus, and the stomach, and the intestine, and the colon, the urethral tract, the womb, the ears, the eyes, are all lined by this inner skin. Nothing is inside the body that has not penetrated one or the other of those skins and gotten into the tissues and fluid beneath that skin. Your food is actually prepared for your use. It is actually digested and prepared for absorption into the bloodstream outside the body, outside that inner skin, in a hollow tube, in the lumen of a hollow tube that passes through the body and that is lined with that inner skin. Urine in the bladder is outside the body. Feces in the colon are outside the body. A baby in its mother's womb is outside her body. It is outside that inner skin. Your health depends upon the condition of the fluids and the tissues that are between those two inner skins. Those two skins, I should say. Two inner ones. Anytime anybody breaks one of those skins and injects something into the tissues or fluids under that skin, something that has no business in that human body, he perpetrates a crime against life. Anytime you introduce anything into your body that gets beneath one or the other of those skins and gets into your tissues and fluids that has no business there, you injure yourself. Now, what is it that has no business there? Anything that cannot be transformed into living structure is a poison. It doesn't matter what it is. It may be common, ordinary earth. It may be chalk. Or it may be something that is much more violently toxic than these substances. Anything that cannot be transformed into living structure by the nutritive processes is a poison. This is the reason that the waste matter, which is made up of the same materials that went into your body originally as food, is a poison. It is now in a condition that it is no longer useful. It is no longer transformable into living structure. It is a foreign body, so to say. And it has no business there, and it must be eliminated. It must be cast out. And if the process of draining that material away from the tissues and fluids of the body is normal, and if the excretion of that material from the bloodstream is normal, then your blood, your lymph, and your tissues will be kept sweet and clean, and you will maintain a state of health. If, on the other hand, the organs of elimination falter in their function, that is, if elimination is inhibited, there is a retention of part of the normal waste of life, what the physiologists call metabolites. I'm sure all of you know what that is. It's another one of those incidents where it's profitable to use $15 words so that people won't know what you're talking about and they'll think you're very wise. Waste matter. There is a retention of a part of the waste that should be eliminated, and it accumulates in the blood, in the lymph, in the tissues, producing at that condition of self-poisoning. Now we have applied to that condition the term toxemia. Now what does it mean? It's another $15 word. It comes from two Greek roots. Toxin, meaning poison, and hemia, meaning blood. Toxemia simply means poison blood. It means an accumulation of toxic waste in the bloodstream. Now, if you look up the word toxemia in a medical dictionary, you'll find it listed about 12 times with a different definition under each one. There are all kinds of toxemia. But the toxemia that I'm talking to you about tonight is an auto-generated toxemia. Not only is it auto-generated, but it is a constant. It is something that you have with you all the time. It fluctuates. It goes up or down, depending upon your functioning capacity. And this rises and falls in keeping with the rise and fall of your nerve energy. And your nerve energy rises and falls in keeping with your mode of living. So that you're more toxic at one time than you are at another. Now, when toxins accumulate in the body or in the blood and lymph to the point where they become a menace to life, something has to be done about it. The organs of elimination have permitted that accumulation because they are not able to eliminate the waste as fast as it is formed. They have permitted it to accumulate because their functioning power has been impaired. How then are we to get rid of it? The only way that it can be done is for old Mother Nature, which in this case is your body, to develop vicarious or compensatory channels of elimination. One of the most commonly used channels of elimination is the mucous membrane or the inner skin of the body. Now, the outer skin is commonly, frequently used as such a channel of elimination also. In this case, we have various types of skin eruption by means of which toxic matter is sent out. But in the inner skin, the third method of eliminating toxic waste is by means of an inflammatory condition that gives rise to what we call a catarrh. a common cold in the superficial of the nasal membrane. The first cold in infancy represents an established toxemia, and that cold is a process of vicarious or compensatory elimination. It comes into existence, that is, it develops or evolves when there is a need for a vicarious elimination. It lasts from an hour to several days, depending upon how toxemic you are and how badly or how not badly you abuse yourself in treatment, until the toxic material in your blood and lymph has been reduced to the toleration point, and then the symptoms automatically subside. And whatever you last used, you credit with having cured you. Only today, a lady said to me, with reference to another man who lectures frequently in your sea, that this man says, well, Dr. Shelton gets results with his methods, and I get results with my methods, and somebody else gets results with other methods, and so on. We're all doing good. I don't agree with that statement at all. The theory among the American Indians was that when there was an eclipse of the sun, it represented a large squirrel devouring the sun. In order to prevent the sun from being destroyed, the Indian medicine man and some of the braves would decorate themselves, as Indian medicine men could, and they'd get their tommy hawks and they'd go out and chant their incantations and they'd threaten the squirrel with their tommy hawk. And I have the word of a man who spent 70 years of his life among the Indians a long time ago, who saw this operation a number of times. I have his word for it that the sun always came out all right. They actually succeeded in fighting away that squirrel and saving the sun. It doesn't matter what kind of treatment you use if the person has a cold. It will automatically cease, just like that eclipse automatically ceases when the sun or the earth or the moon move away so that the shadow is no longer cast upon that sun. The sun survives automatically, and so do you, irrespective of treatment. Some people get drunk when they have a cold. Others take aspirin. Some take a hot bath. Some take a cabinet bath. They sweat and they sweat. And they really get out a lot of water. And others take a mustard foot bath. Some go on orange juice. Some take penicillin. Not so long ago, they were taking antihistamine. That was a wonderful cure for cold. I counted the cures for cold once. I counted them up one by one that have been discovered and invented from remote primitive times down to the present. And I found 6,000,001. Now, of course, if you want to recount and see whether my count is accurate, that's all right. But 6,000,001 cures for colds, and not one of them worth a dime a carload. But everybody that's been having colds all down the ages has been recovering from their colds simply because it is the process of recovery. But the individual who recovers from a cold does not recover from his mode of living that impairs his functioning power. He does not recover from the mode of living that is using up his nerve energy in excess of his ability to recuperate it or regenerate it during the hours that he allots to rest and repose. So he continues on in his state of innervation, and he continues to build more toxemia. So in a little while, he develops another crisis, another cold, tonsillitis, laryngitis, stomatitis, gastritis, colitis, diarrhea, something of the kind. Some kind of a compensatory eliminating process. If it's a woman, it may be leukorrhea. They get rid of a lot of toxic waste in that way. The toxic condition of the body is reduced again to the toleration point, the symptoms subside. The doctor that was called in was a marvelous doctor. He cured me in a rush. That remedy he used was a wonderful remedy. I told you last night that all schools of healing, irrespective of their theories and their practices, whether they belong to the remote past or to the present or come into existence next week, all ride the glory on the self-healing powers of the human body. And the process that we call disease is one of the most important of those healing powers. All down the ages, the so-called healing professions have been fighting the very thing upon which salvation of the life of the individual depends. When you were a little boy, now I haven't seen any of you smoke, I may be talking out of turn here, but well, I'll assume that some of you have. You know, the process of becoming a man involves somewhere along the line smoking. If you don't smoke nowadays, you're a sissy. So all you took your first cigarette, and you got nice and sick. There was vertigo, there was headache, there was nausea, there was vomiting. I remember the first time I tried some tobacco, it was in the form of snuff. I was just a little bit of a fella, not much bigger than the can of snuff itself. And I thought before the process ended that I was going to get my socks up as well as everything else. Now, all of that was simply a means of throwing off that poison. But if you keep on using it, you build what's called toleration. And you get to after a while, instead of using just a little bit of one cigarette and getting sick, you feel sick if you don't have two packages a day. When you reach that point, you can get sick from tobacco poisoning or from nicotine poisoning only by taking the nicotine poisoning in excess of your toleration. And you can have all the symptoms of acute nicotine poisoning. You can have nausea and vomiting and all the other symptoms that go with it by taking your nicotine in excess of your toleration. The same thing takes place when a toxemic condition develops in the body. As time goes on, you develop more and more toleration for it, so that it takes more of it to bring on an acute crisis. But there's chronic poisoning resulting in chronic trouble. So that you develop the so-called chronic disease. Instead of having a frequent cold, now you've got the power of the nose and throat. Well, that's all a cold is, an acute guitar of the nose and throat instead of a chronic one. You've got what you call sinus. Of course, you were born with sinus. What you mean is that you've got sinus inflammation, or if you want to use the medical term, you have sinus infection. You have hay fever, or you have asthma, or you have nephritis, or cystitis, or you have colitis, or proctitis, or some other of the many catarrhal diseases in all parts of the body that are lying with that mucous membrane or inner skin. Any part of the body that is lying with that inner skin can develop a catarrhal condition, a catarrhal disease. That is, it can be used as a fontanelle through which to leak out of the body a lot of accumulated waste. I picked up a textbook on pathology here in one of your bookstores Saturday. It was published in 1948, so it's not too hoary with antiquity as medical books go. Usually when a medical book is 2 years old, it is out of date. That doesn't mean that they make such rapid progress. It means that they have to change so often because they don't progress. we go around in circles. But nonetheless, reading this book on psychology, I ran across a statement that was somewhat of a surprise to me. Not that it expressed an error, because it expressed a truth, but it was one that, so far as I know, had never before been stated in a medical work. That is to the effect that special pathology is merely a part of general pathology. Now, when you study general pathology, you study all about inflammation. You study about atrophy, which is a wasting of a part. And you study about hypertrophy of a part, which is an increase in the number of cells in it. You have that when you have an enlarged tonsil, for example. And you study about hyperplasia, which is an increase in the number of cells and in the cells and in the fibers of the part. You have that, for example, when you have a tumor and a cancer. And then when you study special pathology, you study about these identical same things, inflammation, atrophy, hypertrophy, hyperplasia, in an organ, rather than in a general way. You study about inflammation in the liver, for example, or an abscess in the liver, or you study about hypertrophy of the liver, or hyperplasia of the liver. I'm sorry if I have to use these terms that you're not acquainted with, but heretofore, inflammation in the liver has been one disease, and inflammation in the tonsils has been another disease, and inflammation in the appendix has been a third disease, and inflammation in the brain, whoever had that. Nobody ever used his brain enough to not cause it to be inflamed, but inflammation in the stomach was another disease and so on. The same condition in different locations were named according to the location as diseases. Now let's see what we get. Rhinitis. You know what a rhinoceros is. Rhino is a Greek word meaning nose, and the rhino has one. But so do you, and rhinitis is inflammation of the lining membrane of the nose. That's all. You have it when you have a cold. You have it in catarrh. You can also have it if you practice the old habit of our grandfathers and grandmothers of taking snuff up the nose. Nothing, if they call it. Maybe they got to dipping it. Then they got to pour it down under their lips. The tobacco habit has given us many very beautiful habits. Well, then you have pharyngitis, which is inflammation of the pharynx, laryngitis, which is inflammation of the larynx, tonsillitis, which is inflammation of the tonsils, bronchitis, which is inflammation of the bronchial tube, gastritis, which is inflammation of the stomach, but you have stomachitis in the mouth. That's inflammation of the mouth. And then you have duodenitis, which is inflammation of the duodenum, cholangitis, which is inflammation of the gall duct, cholecystitis, which is inflammation of the gallbladder, and hepatitis, which is inflammation of the liver, pancreatitis, which is inflammation of the pancreas, appendicitis is inflammation of the appendix. Colitis is inflammation of the colon. Meatitis is inflammation of the woman. It's even worse than that. The womb has a little neck that they call the cervix, which is a Latin term meaning neck, and it can be inflamed on the neck, and that's cervicitis. It has an inner lining, which is called the endothelium. If that's inflamed, it's endometritis. Then it has an investing membrane, which covers the outside of it, and that's the perineum on it, and if there's inflammation in that, it's perineumitis, and in the heart muscle is known as the myocardium, from a Greek word meaning heart, and muscle, from two Greek words. If the inflammation is in the muscle, it's myocarditis. If it's in the lining membrane of the heart, it's endocarditis. If it's in the investing membrane of the heart, it's pericarditis. If it's all three of them, it's perimyoendocarditis. And so we go. And we can go on through the body. Itis is a little Greek suffix meaning inflammation. So if you see itis, remember that means inflammation. And then the word that follows it, that precedes it. I mean, the part of the word that precedes it tells you where it's located. Now, they don't tell you you have inflammation in the womb because they can't charge you $5 for that. They say you have meatitis. That's worth $5. And besides that, if they tell you that you have inflammation in the womb, you might suspect that inflammation is inflammation, wherever it's located. And so it is. It's all the same thing. They've got more than 20,000 diseases. And how do we do it? Let's go down into the lower end of the colon. We get down here, way down on the left side, and we have an escape part of the colon that we call the sigmoid. And right down in the last 2 or 3 inches of the colon is a little part that we call the rectum. Now, when you have inflammation in the rectum, they don't call it rectitis, they call it proctitis. Well, what I want to bring out is, if you have inflammation of the sigmoid, that's sigmoiditis. Now, these two parts of the colon are continuous with each other. They're not really parts. They're divided off there for convenience of somebody or the other. There's no line of demarcation between the one or the other. You can't find any line that divides the rectum from the sigmoid. But let's imagine a little hairline that goes around on the inside that divides it. Now, we get just a 16th of an inch over on one side of that little hairline with a little inflammation and we've got proctitis. We go just a 16th of an inch on the other side and we've got sigmoiditis. Every quarter of an inch of anatomy calls for another name. And that's the way you get 20,000 diseases. It's almost impossible to imagine how many diseases human beings can have if they just keep dividing them up in little bitty parts like that and giving a separate name to inflammation in each little part. I don't know why we can't divide them up into several million cells and name the disease after each cell so we can have several million diseases. Think of all the specialists we could have if we had a specialist for each particular cell in the body. They went so far over in London once as to actually create specialists for diseases of the navel. Yes, they did. Specialists for the diseases of the navel. Will Rogers once said that he went to had something wrong with his right eye, and he went to an eye specialist in Chicago. Had him look after his eye, and he said, "I'm very sorry, I'm a left eye specialist. The right eye specialist is across the hall there." What's the matter with a physician that can't take care of the human body? That he has to fuss it out. One fellow takes care of your eyes, and the other your nose, and another your throat, and another your stomach, and another your womb, and another your big toe, and so on and so forth. When the same thing that will produce inflammation in the little finger on the left hand will produce inflammation in the big toe on the right foot. The same internal condition, the same blood and flesh condition that I've just described to you as toxemia produces all of your troubles. I mean by that it is basic. There can be other and complicating causes superadded to that toxic state. But they're secondary, and they're unimportant in the absence of the primary and basic cause. Now, how do we develop that? Let's go back. A mode of living, such as I described to you in the first part of my lecture last night, that uses up nerve energy in excess of your ability to recuperate it or to regenerate it during the hours of rest and repose. Lowers nerve energy. Nerve energy is functioning power. When nerve energy is lowered, elimination is checked. Decretion and excretion are both checked. Then we have an accumulation of the normal waste of life in the blood and lymph and tissue. This is what we mean by the term toxic. I said secretion is checked, as well as excretion. Excretion is really a more technical term for elimination. When secretion is checked, the digestive juices, among other secretions of the body, are not produced in adequate quantities are in sharper quality. One of the first noticeable signs of this will be perhaps indigestion. Now, a lot of you people go around suffering with indigestion and don't realize you have it, because you have no pain, you have no distress, you have no discomfort. You haven't any symptoms that indicate to you that there's anything wrong. Nothing hurts me, I eat anything I want. How many thousands of times have I heard that? And then a year or two later, the same individual comes back and says, I don't know what's wrong with me, I can't eat anything. Everything I eat turns to gas. What do you think has happened to him in the meantime? He's just become a little more toxemic and a little more enervated. And now his symptoms are beginning to show up. But let us keep this thing in mind. Diseases, whatever we name them, do not come into existence full-blown. Disease is an evolution. It starts in minute and imperceptible beginnings, and it gradually evolves, step by step, stage by stage, from that first cold or first diarrhea in infancy, to diabetes, or breast disease, or cancer, or tuberculosis, or hardening of the arteries, or heart disease, or apoplexy, or some other of the so-called degenerative diseases of later life by the time you are 35 to 40 or 50. All the time that evolution of disease is going on, it is interspersed at intervals, varying intervals, with crises and toxemia, by which the body seeks to eliminate at least the excessive or the accumulation above its ability to tolerate. You have cold, you have tonsillar trouble, you have other acute troubles, you may have so-called influenza, you may have typhoid or pneumonia, or something else of that type. All of these are merely crises and toxemia by which the body seeks to escape from its toxic overload. Unfortunately, you have been led to believe that all you need to do when you're ill in that way is to be treated. Until you're cured. After which, of course, they can bury you. When the symptoms have subsided, the treatment stops. And what do you do? Well, like the sorrow that was washed, you return to your wallowing in the mire. You go right back to the same mode of living that was responsible for your trouble in the first place. And you soon are in a condition where you need another crisis to clean out again. They come and they go. Time goes on. But nonetheless, there is a progressive deterioration of the tissue, of your body, of the organ, of your body, and the one that breaks down first is said to be your primary disease, and the next one that follows, in order, is said to be a complication. It's merely a progressive, and step by step, and stage by stage, wrecking of a body, of an organism, that is being poisoned by the retention of its own waste matter, consequent upon a mode of living that impairs its functioning power so that it is unable to keep itself clean. Internally clean, I mean. And eternally clean. You plant an acorn seed and you get a little sprout. Now, only a Hindu magician claims that he can grow that oak tree overnight. All of you know that it takes years to produce an oak tree from a little spot or spray. It should be equally easy for you to recognize that it takes years for you to develop cancer. The little spot came into existence perhaps when you were an infant, maybe even before. The way to prevent cancer is to start early with a mode of living that maintains health. Cancer does not develop in healthy tissue. If you can keep thinking, if your body healthy, then you can avoid cancer. Not only can you avoid cancer, but you can avoid heart disease and diabetes and heart trouble and apoplexy and all of these other diseases that are troubling so many of us today. But it's first necessary that we recognize not only the unity of pathology, that is, that it's all one, and the evolution of it, that we progress step by step and stage by step from the simple to the complex, from the cold to cancer, from the cold to apoplexy, from the cold to bite disease, from the skin rash, the little skin rash that the little baby has that a few days after birth, to perhaps diabetes at later life. We must not only recognize that, but we must go back to the evolution, back to the initial pathology, and recognize its causes. Toxemia is the immediate cause. Innovation produces toxemia. But innovation is produced by a mode of living that uses up our nerve energy in excess. Now you can understand, I believe. Some of you last night told me I hadn't told you anything that you hadn't heard before. Of course, I knew better. I've got a lot more to tell you before we're through that you haven't heard before. But now I believe you can understand why I stressed so much last evening the many factors in our mode of living that waste and that dissipate our energy. Is merely the foundation for this evening's talk. The dissipation of energy, the waste of energy, is the first step in the evolution of any pathology, any disease. Name it what you will. I've had a number of questions come up to me here during the past few nights. What is the cause of arthritis? What is the cause of heart trouble? What is the cause of diabetes? What is the cause of this or that or the other? I have given you the cause. I want to give you some of the superadded causes. One of the superadded causes, one of the most common of them, is the absorption of poison from the digestive tract. Now, why do you absorb poison from the digestive tract? The normal products of digestion are not poisons. They're amino acids, monosaccharides, fatty acids, vitamins, minerals, water. These are the normal substances that foods are broken down into in the process of digestion, and these are the substances that should be absorbed into the bloodstream and carried to your cells and tissues to be utilized in building new cells and new tissues. Why do you get poisoning from the digestive tract instead of nutrients? Again, it's because secretion has been checked or impaired by your innervation, so that your food, instead of digesting as it should, undergoes bacterial decomposition, fermentation and putrefaction. Your fat, the oils and the butter and the cream and all the things of that kind that you eat become rancid in your digestive tract. Your proteins rot. The digestive tract becomes a brewery. The sugars and starches are converted into alcohol. Acetic acid, carbon dioxide, and water. And the water is the only thing in it that is of any value to you. And these poisons, not all of them, thank heaven, but some of them are absorbed into your bloodstream to be added to the toxemia from which you are already suffering. Oh, you say those toxins will be carried to the liver and destroyed. Quite true that the liver is quite a deficient organ destroying these toxins that are stored from the bloodstream. But don't forget that under this condition, your liver is also innervated. Its own functioning power has been reduced. Besides, it is already laboring under an overload of toxemia. Oh, it doesn't succeed. and this addition of poisoning from the digestive tract, which is poisoning from the outside, exogenous poisoning rather than internal poisoning or self or auto-generated poisoning. Complicate the simple diseases that arise out of a toxic excess. Now, I use the term excess because I mean by that any accumulation of toxins above the toleration point. We shouldn't have more than a little bit of toxins in the bloodstream at any time. The bloodstream is never free of toxins because at all times it is carrying waste from the tissues to the organs of elimination. There's always a certain amount there as a normal factor of blood. Impossible to get rid of all of it. It becomes a menace to life only when it accumulates in sufficient quantity to evoke what we call reaction, and I don't like that term reaction in reference to the human body. The body acts, it also reacts, but we use the term reaction 99 times out of 100 when we're talking about a primary action, not a reaction. That's a technical point that you needn't worry your mind over. The point is that the toxins that normally circulate in the bloodstream become a danger only when they accumulate far above that normal amount. And when they become, when that excessive amount becomes chronic, then we have chronic trouble. Remember this, chronic disease is due to chronic provocation. Disease begins where cause begins, and it persists where cause persists. It's hard to remove the disease in. I'll go into that more fully in my lecture Friday evening when I talk about recovery. But here are the cure remedies of cause of your trouble. Now I know that many of you had your tonsils removed, your teeth pulled, your appendix and gallbladder taken out, your woman ovaries and tubes removed, your seminal vesicles, perhaps your prostate gland, your deviated septum whittled out, your sinuses chiseled out or drained. You've had all kinds of things done to you because these things were said to be foci of infection. Nobody ever stopped to ask the question, how and why did they become such? I remember some years ago I was called to see a woman in the city of San Antonio. She was in a nursing home there in the city. She had arthritis. Or you've had her, have it either way you want. Every movable joint in that poor woman's body was arthritic. Even her jaw, as I said the other night, she still had enough motion in the jaw to be able to eat. She gave me this story. 6 years before I was called to see her, she developed arthritis. I believe it was in the one ankle. She went to see her family physician. He examined her and got through. He said, you have arthritis. I can't do a thing for you. We don't know what to do for our life. If I had your trouble, he said, I would go out to Denver to Dr. Taylor. You think she took his advice? Of course not. Whoever takes sound advice. He went next door to another fellow, and he said, it's your teeth. You'll pull those out, and you'll be all right. So he pulled her teeth. You think she got all right? Of course not. She developed arthritis in the knee. So now she had it in the ankle and the knee. She went to another physician. He said, it's your tonsils. We'll take out your tonsils. Then you'll be all right. So they removed her tonsils. Then what do you think happened? Well, she got well, of course. She didn't do anything of the kind. She developed arthritis in the other ankle and the other knee and in the hip. So she went to another physician. He made an examination. He said, it's the gallbladder. You've got an infected gallbladder. We'll remove the gallbladder and you'll be all right. So they removed her gallbladder. While they had her open, of course, they wanted to give her money for it. Give her a bargain, they took out the appendix also. You think she got well? Nope. She developed arthritis in the shoulders and the spinal column. So she went to another physician. He found that one of her tubes and ovaries was infected. We removed the tube and ovary, and you'll be all right. So they removed it. You think she got all right? She did not. The arthritis spread to the joints of the arms and hands and fingers and so on. So then it was that she came to San Antonio, and she went into the largest hospital in the city there, and they discovered that the other ovary and tube were infected. They said, we'll remove that, and you'll be all right. They removed that, and then they took her over to a nursing home, and there she was, in that helpless and hopeless condition, a condition now that nobody could do anything for. If she had been properly cared for from the beginning, she would have been well in 3 or 4 weeks, and she could have saved all that 6 years of suffering, all those operations, and all that expense, and could have been enjoying life. Now they said to her, we don't know why you haven't gotten well. We've removed all the causes of your trouble. Fact is, they hadn't removed any cause at all. They'd been removing organs. Organs are not the cause of disease. They'd been removing effects, symptoms, local pathology, but not cause. I talked to the lady and I told her my method of caring for arthritis, and she said, isn't that the same kind of a method that Dr. Tilden uses? And I said, yes. He says, I wish I'd gone to him 6 years ago when my physician told me to. He should have, but she didn't. They had removed all the causes of her trouble, they said. And she didn't get well. I've seen that over and over and over during the past 35 years. I've seen men relieved of all of their teeth for arthritis, and every tooth was sound. I've seen tonsils taken out when there was nothing wrong with them, and they shouldn't come out even if there is. There's just as much intelligence in removing a tonsil because it's inflamed as there is in removing the heart because it's inflamed, cutting off the head because you have a headache, cutting off your throat if you're a corn. One's just as sensible as the other. And I've seen it over and over and over and over. They're still doing it. Although they now admit that the removal of the tonsil makes the child more likely to develop polio, that the removal of the tonsil increases the incidence of arthritis instead of decreasing it, that the removal of the tonsil is rarely necessary, they're still taking them out by wholesale. Because why? There's money in it. The lust for money is a root of evil. Some of you don't like that particular translation. I suggest that you look up the original Greek and you discover it doesn't say the love of money is the root of evil. It says the lust for money is a root of evil. There's more than one root. Most plants have more than one root. Now, it isn't just arthritis that your organs are removed from. They take them out for anemia, for neuritis, and for various other troubles. And they take them out just because it's good money in it. Not that there's anything wrong. Just take them out on general principles. And if they have succeeded in converting you into a mass of scar tissue and a bundle of nerves by this continuous operation, and you reach that point where you've got nothing but symptoms and you're constantly talking about them and worrying about them and they can't take out any more organs without killing you, they tell you your disease is all imaginary. What you need is a psychiatrist. Psychiatry is another racket that came into existence to take the place, take some of the burden off the fellows that were producing the trouble. Some years ago, Dr. S. Weir Mitchell, who was a famous neurologist at the time, followed Dr. King, who was one of the famous surgeons at the time, famous endocrinologist, on the platform in Philadelphia. Dr. King had estimated, so he said in his talk, that during the course of his lifetime as a surgeon, he had added something like 30,000, I believe, years to human life. Dr. Mitchell came upon the platform following him and he said, I do not want to question the accuracy of Dr. King's estimate of the number of years he has added to human life by his surgical operation. I only want to say that if he could see them as I see them, or as the neurologist sees them, he said, he'd ask himself, is it worth it? You know what he means? It means that operating on people, cutting into their nervous system, subjecting them to repeated nervous shock from operations, wrecks the nervous system, brings on neurotic and psychotic symptoms. As Dr. Henry Lindlaw used to say over and over and over again, cutting into the ovaries is like cutting into the brain. And our insane asylums are full of women who have had their ovaries removed and have gone crazy as a result. And the streets are full of them that are not crazy enough to be put into the asylum, or that we ought to have some other kind of a place to put them. From the same cause. I wonder, Dr. Mitchell says, he would ask himself, is it worth it? Yes, the idea of restoring you to health by taking you apart piece by piece and consigning you to the surgical garbage pail is quite popular today, and the practice is very profitable also. But if you want health, you'll avoid practices of that kind. Save your money. I remember being called in to see a case of supposed appendicitis a few years ago. I went into a home that was the picture of poverty. It was during the Depression days. There was a woman lying on the bed there that was supposed to have appendicitis. Three physicians had agreed that it was appendicitis and that she had to be operated upon before morning or she would die. I looked around the home and saw the way the children were dressed and the way the home was furnished. And the man there sitting there in his overalls, and I said, how much money do you make? He says, I get $15 a week. That's almost as much as you get now on your Social Security, isn't it? You don't get enough Social Security to live on, and you get too much to die on. That's the trouble with it. So he eats out a miserable existence. But nonetheless, that was what he was getting. So I said, how the devil do they expect you to pay $500 for an operation? He said, that's how I happened to call you. I went to the foreman of the foundry, steel mill rather, where I worked, to see if I could arrange for a loan to pay for the operation. And when I told the man, my foreman, what was wrong with my wife? He said, don't you let them operate on your wife, and he told me to call you. Well, I examined his wife, and I made up my mind in the twinkling of an eye that she did not have appendicitis. I said, if you do as I tell you, I'll have you back at your house for it in 3 days. He says, if I don't have to have an operation, I'll do it. On the morning of the fourth day, the woman went back to her housework without an operation. You can imagine how well they loved me down there. Given their wages, I cut out some of their income every once in a while. Now, all of our diseases grew out of the causes that I have just mentioned for you. Cancer? Cancer develops at a site of chronic irritation, so they tell us. But they never tell us what produces the chronic irritation. Cancer of the womb follows upon a long-standing pectoral inflammation of the womb. What causes pectoral inflammation of the womb? Proxemia plus intestinal absorption of poison. This causes the pectoral inflammation of the womb. Large numbers of ulcers of the stomach evolve into cancer. How do we develop ulcers of the stomach? Well, first we become toxemic. First we become enervated and then toxemic. And then we overeat and we develop gastritis. Well, it's an acute case. In a few days we're well again. But we keep on with our abuse of ourselves. And then we have another case of gastritis. And after a time the gastric condition becomes chronic. We have chronic gastric catarrh. That means the chronic inflammation of the lining membrane of the stomach. Time goes on, and that chronic inflammation becomes hardening of the tissues. Hardening is followed by a breaking down of tissues. We have ulceration. All going out of the persistence of the original cause of toxemia. And then, on the persistence of that same cause, the hardened edges of that ulcer take on what we call fungation, and that's another name for cancer. With first irritation, then inflammation, then induration or hardening, then ulceration, and then fungation. And that those are the major steps in your evolution of cancer from a simple catarrh to begin with. And growing out of a mode of living that uses up nerve energy in excess. It doesn't matter whether the cancer develops in the breast, in the rectum, in the stomach, in the intestine, in the womb, or somewhere else. That is the order of its evolution. And it can be checked at any point along that line by removing the cause at any point up to the actual development of the cancerous state itself. The trouble with our handling of cancer today is that we begin at the wrong end. We begin at the end point rather than somewhere back along the chain of cause and effect where the evolution of the pathology can be stopped. I remember some years ago a woman had a lump in her breast. And there was a great lot of publicity in the newspapers in those days and there is yet, urging you to go and see your doctor if you have a lump, if you have a mole that starts growing, if you have a persistent bleeding from somewhere, if it's in the body, if you continue to lose weight, from some unknown cause and so on and so forth. You know the seven dangers that you get. You hear them on the radio almost every day. You read them in the newspapers and in the magazines. Oh yes. So this lady went to a physician, he examined her breast and he says, it's not cancer yet. Come back in 6 months and I'll examine you again. In other words, let's wait until it evolves into cancer. And then we'll begin to try to do something about it. Let's wait until the condition reaches that point where no power under heaven can help you. And then we'll try to do something. In the meantime, let's ignore it. Come back in 6 months and I'll examine you again. Why did he say, come back in 6 months and I'll examine you? Because he didn't know what to do anyhow. That's all he could say. Cystitis. It's a pectoral inflammation of the bladder. It can be very painful. It can cause you a lot of trouble. Keep you up at night. Well, you go to a physician and he'll irrigate your bladder. Some strong caustic solution. And you keep it up for a long time, he may ruin you in the process. You never think that cystitis has a cause, and that if the cause is removed, the cystitis will automatically and spontaneously get well. Hemorrhoids, varicose veins. Hemorrhoids are varicose veins.
only they're in the rectum rather than the leg. What have we here? We have an innervation and a toxemic condition and a gradual weakening of the walls of those veins. And we have pressure from above, from constipation, or from a tumor, or we have the person standing all the time, so that the pressure of gravity is helping to cause an accumulation of an excess of blood in those weakened, in the vessels with the weakened wall, and they begin to stretch, and they stretch, and they stretch, and you've got varicose veins. All coming out of the same cause that produced your cold the first time you had them. Only today, I was reading in that same work on pathology that I told you about, and it said that perhaps in varicose veins, and perhaps in most cases, there is a congenital weakness of the walls of the veins. Now, a congenital weakness simply means that they are weak from birth. There isn't any need, any necessity to assume a congenital weakness in these cases when you think of all the thousands of weakening influences to which we are daily and hourly subjecting ourselves in our insane mode of life today. We have enough weakening influences with us at all times without having to call in congenital weakness, heredity, or anything of the kind to account for these things. They guess, of course, that there's a congenital weakness. They guess about a lot of other things that they're hereditary. Heredity is a peg from which you hang anything that you don't know anything about. Blame it on heredity. Then wherever you find out the true cause later, you'll discover heredity had nothing to do with it. Heredity accounts for the fact that you have blue eyes or brown, red hair or black. You have long legs and short legs and things of that kind. That you're a Negro or white or a Japanese or something else. Heredity accounts for that. But it doesn't account for your disease.
In this case, what is your opinion of frozen food? My opinion is that they're second class or third grade substitutes for fresh fruits and vegetables. They're processing the fruits and vegetables nowadays before they freeze them. You'll get your strawberries and other types of berries that are frozen, you'll find them heavily loaded with white sugar. And then they're frozen, then you thaw them out, and then you cook them, and this hasn't got much value. Do you approve of milk in a diet? If so, what kind? Do you approve of cheese in a diet? Cheese is one of those compromises that we have to make in our modern diet simply because we do not have sufficient quantities of the normal elements of the human diet to go around. If everybody in the United States were to cease all of their wrong eating habits tomorrow and everybody went on a normal human diet, we eat up all the normal food supply that we raise in this country within a week. So we use cheese as a substitute for what we don't have. But it's not the best food in the world.
One nutritional authority has said that body disintegration begins after 7 straight days of fasting. It has also been said that the body does not store vitamin C and that the brain requires continual supply of carbohydrates for efficient function. Wouldn't a long fast, as you have advocated, for some patients be detrimental?
You see, this question is based on the assumption that this alleged nutritional authority knows what he's talking about. There isn't a single statement that he made that has any true thing. Probably one of these food peddlers that poses as a nutritional authority that you've been listening to made that statement. Why do they make those statements? Because if you fast, you won't buy their junk. One of my patients went into a health food store in San Antonio once and he said to the young lady who runs the store, why don't you handle Dr. Shelton's books? She says, I'm in business to make money. If I sell my patients, my patents, those books, they won't come back and buy my foods. Another health food store man in New York City. Mark Handling, my boy. In spite of the fact that there are some that are not. What is a natural cure for venereal disease, if there is any? Have heard that male fern root was recommended by a well-known nutritional authority for worms. What would you suggest?
Well, now, in the first place, there is no natural cure for anything. Nature is not engaged in the curing business, and she hasn't turned out any cures. I've repeatedly urged you during the course of these lectures to forget cure and curing. Now, I might say to you, as I've said so often in my writings and in my lectures, the cures may come and the cures may go, but the curing goes on forever. You never lose your faith in curing. No matter how often the curing professions change their cures, and you know they change them more often than fashions in women's hats. I'm sure you've all heard the story about the man who was, one of his neighbors saw him running down the street as fast as he could with a bundle under his arm, a box under his arm, and the neighbor stopped him and said, What's your hurry? He says, I just bought my wife a new hat and I'm trying to get her home before the fashion changes. Well, that's the same way in cures. The fashion changes so rapidly that by the time you become acquainted with one, they've got another one. And it doesn't matter which school you go to, it's the same thing in all of them. It's a constant succession of new cures, new wonder cures, new sensations. And you keep on believing in cures. Nature is not engaged in curing and she hasn't turned out any. Keep that in mind. And stop talking about and believing in cures. Now, venereal disease isn't any different from any other disease. It means disease of the venereal organs, that's all. It gets well. Gonorrhea, your own thing. Dr. Cabot says, Dr. Cabot is regarded as the highest living authority on medicine. He had to leave Boston because he was too good. The medical profession ran him out of the state of Massachusetts. I think he's with the Mayo Clinic at the present time. But nonetheless, he says in his work, A Handbook of Medicine, that gonorrhea gets well of itself without treatment. But he asks, we make people believe that it's serious in all cases in order to make them behave themselves. Those are not his exact words, but to that effect. I think there was something else there now about some kind of a root
for worms.
I've handled various kinds of worms. I've had cases of various kinds of worms. Tapeworms, footworms, threadworms, various other kinds of worms. I find all I have to do is stop the patient from eating for 3 or 4 days, or I put him on juice for 3 or 4 days, and he loses his worms. Same thing with so-called immediate dysentery. I had a professor. Worked for the Standard Oil Company. He was teaching these children of the employees of the Standard Oil Company down in South America. They had him down there on a big salary. He developed what they call amoebic dysentery. Well, they gave him all his amoebicides. They almost killed him instead of the amoeba with the amoebicides. They didn't do him any good. So he went to New York at their expense. He stayed there for a while, and they fed him with plenty of poison. And then he came down from New York to my place. And in 1 week, he was free of his amoebic dysentery. How? I just stopped feeding the amoeba. I stopped him from eating.
Why do I have dull pain in my lower back when on feet all day long? I'm 40 pounds overweight. My doctor's my doctor can't find a reason. What can I do for it?
I've heard that so many thousands of times it gets monotonous. My doctor can't find a reason. He doesn't know the cause of a single disease that he deals with. From a cold to cancer, he doesn't know the cause of a single disease of an osteology. Of course he can't find a reason.
Also, conjunctivitis for the eye.
Well, he has conjunctivitis, you say it's of the eyes. Where else could it be?
Conjunctivitis is the catarrhal inflammation of the lining of the eye, which is called the conjunctivitis. What causes it? It's a catarrhal condition. It grows out of toxemia. It's the same thing that causes a cold. Or anitis in the other part of the body. How to get rid of it? I'll tell you Friday.
My doctor tells me my blood is too thick. Please tell me how to go about thinning my blood.
I tell you what I'd do if you had another doctor. I'll pay him off and leave him off altogether.
Has alfalfa or sunflower seed any nutritional value?
Of course they have. I think alfalfa is a wonderful food for horses and cows, as I mentioned a while ago. Sunflower seed are excellent foods. I use them too. Along with the chickens, they like them.
Do you think there is any benefit or necessity in reference to any cooked food?
No, I don't think you have to eat cooked foods. Their cooking adds nothing to food. It always takes from it. Can't get a thing out of cooked food that you can't get in greater abundance out of the uncooked food.
I perspire a lot at night in bed.
Well, now that could be from more than one different condition. It might be a purely nervous condition. It might be that you're sleeping where you're hot. It could be that there's some septic condition somewhere in your body. You find it in tuberculosis, you find it in gonorrhea, you find it in various other septic states of the body. And a check of you might disclose why you do that.
Why are you opposed to wheat as food? Also, what is your attitude towards corn, rye, and barley?
All of those questions were answered previously when I mentioned the fact that all cereals fall outside of the normal diet of the human being.
Regarding herbs, I'm using a combination of alfalfa, red clover blossoms, raspberry leaves, strawberry leaves, peppermint leaves, mace, garlic, papaya, and celery. Are any of them poison? If not, do you still denounce all such herbs?
There may be a little question about cinnamon. I don't think there's any poison in any of the rest of them. The only herbs I have any objection to are the poisonous herbs, the so-called medicinal herbs, the ones that are supposed to cure you of your disease.
Do you advise rubber stockings for varicose veins and swollen ankles?
I do not. If you want to make your varicose veins worse, use rubber stockings or something else of that kind to interfere with the circulation to the leg and weaken the tissues of the leg, including those of the walls of the veins, still more.
Hey, Dr. Shelton, isn't the sock on the foot better than the sock on the chin?
Not always. Some people need a sock on the chin.
Is the walnut a good nutritious nut for the hygienic diet?
Both types of walnuts, the English walnut and the black walnut, are excellent food.
It's much easier to buy nuts already shelled rather than shelling them yourself.
Aren't you a lazy nut?
Yes,
a much better nut if you take it fresh from the shell. And after it's been subjected to the atmosphere for a considerable time, a lot of oxidation has taken place and the oils have become rancid. We get so lazy now that we're too lazy even to chew our food. We buy machines to do it for us.
Children do not masticate nuts too well. Is it all right to place them in a liquefier without blanching them?
If you have a child that doesn't masticate nuts, you have a child that you have miscared for from the beginning. Children normally and naturally chew their foods if they're handled
properly from the start. You don't have to force it on him. You don't have to keep urging him. Now chew your food. Now chew it. Now chew. Now you mustn't swallow without chewing it. They do it normally and naturally, just like other little animals do. Most of you people start your children off with mashed potatoes and scraped apples and mashed bananas and purees and soups and foods that don't have to be chewed, and you keep them on that kind of a diet so long that at the right time of their life, when they should begin to chew instinctively, you keep them on these things and they never learn to chew. The best way is for the child to chew its food and don't flake it and teach it to go on through life flaking those things.
I was told that skin or almonds contain vitamin C. That's in reference to flaking.
Maybe it's possible that there's some vitamin B in the skin of almonds. There's also some prussic acid.
See, can a person improve his health to a high degree even though he has had a considerable amount of root canal and surgery done in his mouth and now has bridge work and some dead teeth?
Yes, he can. Unfortunately, the dentist can't supply him with any teeth that he can do much chewing with, but he can still improve his health considerably in spite of it.
Why is there such a difference of opinion among health educators? Cannot some efforts towards unity and central organization be made?
Well, there's going to be differences of opinion among these alleged health educators so long as they subscribe to different principles. There's no possibility of unity when there's disunity at the base. If you believe that all disease is caused by pressure on a nerve due to a subluxation in the spinal column, and that all disease can be remedied by adjusting that subluxated vertebra, it is not possible for you to get together with somebody who thinks that you might get sick as a consequence of getting drunk occasionally or too long. If you believe that all you have to do to keep well is to keep the kinks out of your spinal column and you can eat 10 penny nails, as B.J. Palmer once said, you can't get together with a Christian Scientist who believes that there is no disease. You know that story about the three people, the Catholic and the Baptist and the Christian Scientist who died and got down to hell? And the devil asked the Catholic, how did you get here? And he explained how he got there. He asked the Baptist, how do you get here? He explained how he got there. He said to the turn to the Christian Scientist, he said, how did you get here? She says, I'm not here.
Penicillitis in 4 days.
I didn't cure anybody in all my life. I never expect to. I'm not in the curing business. The woman didn't have a penicillitis. If she'd had a penicillitis, she wouldn't have gotten well in 4 days. I said I made up my mind in the briefing of an eye that she didn't have a penicillitis. Then she had a diagnosis of appendicitis. 75% of the cases that are operated upon just have a diagnosis of appendicitis. 100% of those people that are operated upon for chronic appendicitis don't have anything wrong with their appendix. There is no such thing as chronic appendicitis.
What is wrong when there is pain at the end of the spine and when bending over is very painful?
Well, straightening up. That could be neuritis. It could be arthritis. It could be some kind of a misplacement. In the fall or something of the kind, there are many things that could cause that pain.
What is your opinion of garlic?
I think that if you eat garlic, you ought to stay away from everybody while you're doing it, and for several hours thereafter. It's not a good food. None of these foods that are rich in mustard oil are suitable for regular use, at least. If you want to use them occasionally, make it very rare. Whether it's garlic, onions, leek, chives, shallots, or whatever it is that's rich in the mustard oil.
Upon arriving, I drank 1 quart of water. I had no breakfast. Is this too much water for the body to handle at one time?
There is no sense in drinking any amount of water, whether it's a thimbleful or a cupful, upon arising in the morning, unless you're thirsty. And if you're thirsty, drink enough to satisfy your thirst and quit. If you're not thirsty, wait until you become thirsty and then drink.
How long have you fasted? Explain why we live to 68 years if we live so badly.
We lived to 68 years. A few years ago, Sir William Harper, who is considered one of the greatest medical men who ever lived, noting the condition of the people when they reached 60 and beyond, recommended chloroforming everybody at the age of 60. Why? Because you're a bunch of bald heads, glass eyes, false teeth, wooden legs, hobbling around, members of the great army of unburied dead, waiting for the undertaker, but not wanting to be buried. You live. You call that living?
Is it advisable for a diabetic who has been taking insulin for 13 years to fast? If not, then what would be the next best program to follow to ensure a long life as possible?
I make it an invariable rule never to accept a diabetic case that has been using insulin for as much as 2 years. As I explained to you last night, it brings about so much deterioration of the islands of Langerhans and the pancreas that it makes it dangerous to take them off. Now, some of them can be taken off it and recover, but you don't know in advance who's going to recover and who's going to die within 24 hours, so I don't take
it. A PhD friend of ours considers common table salt, sodium chloride, necessary to human nutrition and especially necessary in hot climates. He has come back at me with the idea that table salt serves as a catalyst in the body and that is the reason it leaves the body in the same state in which it enters. What do you know about this?
I think there's nothing like being a PhD. If you understand what the B stands for, the pH is pH-double-O-L. Now you can figure out the rest of it, I believe. Sodium chloride has absolutely no business in the human body in the form you take it as common salt. It does not serve as a catalyst. It serves as nothing more than an irritant. I have a PhD too, but I don't brag about it.
What is your estimation of the comparative nutrient value of vegetables grown above the ground in the sunlight and those grown under the ground?
Well, there is considerably more value in the vegetables grown above ground. There's a greater percentage of vitamins in the green vegetables above ground. There's a higher percentage of minerals in those vegetables. There's less starch in them, and in all respects, they're superior to the vegetables that grow underground.
Is meat necessary?
What do you mean by meat? Look it up in the dictionary and you'll discover that it means food. I believe it is. If you mean flesh, I haven't eaten it for 40 years. If it's necessary, I'm going to have to start eating some soon.
Is your method of teaching the same as that of Professor Arnold Eric, who wrote the book Nucleus Healing System?
I know what he wrote. He wrote a lot more about that. My method of caring for my people and my method of teaching has absolutely nothing to do with the Eric program or system. If man did not know the difference between mucus and pus, he's not a man that I think could be trusted to give you reasonable and sensible advice about taking care of yourself.
Is cottage cheese a good food? What about raw cream?
Cottage cheese is among the best of the cheeses. It's
She still remains a compromised food, as I mentioned a while ago.
What was that other food?
Raw cream. Cream is all of the fats are foods that should be taken in moderation.
Some of you like to put a lot of it on your salad, you know, your vegetables and so forth.
And you overeat on creams, and you have a lot of catarrh as a consequence.
Because an excess of butyric acid gives you butyric acid poisoning, that shows up as a catarrh condition.
Are mental disorders hereditary?
I told you during the course of the talk that you ought to forget that idea that disease is hereditary. It's a peg on which we hang all the things that we don't know anything about. The more ignorant we are, the more hereditary diseases we have. And the more we learn about causes, the fewer hereditary diseases we have left.
Can pyorrhea of the gums be cured by fasting or the proper diet of fruit, vegetables, and nuts? Also, how about rheumatism? The old
pyorrhea of the gums can't be cured by anything. But pyorrhea will get well, that is, the patient will get well of his pyorrhea on a fast, or a fast followed by proper food. And by removing all the causes that produce
rheumatism.
How about rheumatism? How about I once gave the definition of rheumatism that it's just one damn thing after another. It's the outgrowth of a toxemic condition, and all you have to do is get rid of the toxic state, and I'll explain that when you find it.
What causes the impotence, and how can it be helped?
Well, impotency is caused by many things. In a great number of cases, it's simply due to defective nutrition. For other cases, it's due to disease of the genital organs. I think in a great majority of cases, it's simply due to sexual excesses.